Well, it came from my own process in life of trying to develop compassion as a person. I've been strongly moved by social injustice my whole life, and I suppose I was born into a background Jewish Holocaust, sort of people running from terror and abuse, so that it was in my drinking water as a child to fight for the voiceless and to look for situations of injustice and try to define myself in opposition to them. So I'd always been that person, but that's different than being a compassionate person, because that's being a sympathetic person. But sympathy has hierarchy in it. You think that you're stronger than the person or the situation that your heart goes out to. Compassion is learning to understand the sympathy with inequality and to feel with others, compassion. And as I was trying to learn compassion, I traveled the country a lot with previous films that were social justice films, but I noticed when I spoke to audiences that I had some learning to do about how to talk to people, because by and large, I was talking to audiences of struggling Americans, poor people, people caught in situations way beyond their control. And then I, who had the luxury to make these films and to look critically at the global situation or the American situation, I'd come in and I'd say to people effectively, you think your life is bad? If you give me 90 minutes, I'll make you feel even worse about it. So it's not enough that you gotta pay the bills and try to keep body and soul together and keep your kids out of trouble and deal with crumbling neighborhoods and a government that turned its back on you and a corporate sector that's raping you. I'm gonna come in here and make you feel even worse about it. All the things you don't know that I know. And I did this for years. And I had a crisis of conscience about it, myself and my colleagues in this field, where I just thought we're sort of like merchants of despair. We're coming in here, we're not giving people anything other than really toxic add-on information. So I looked for ways to talk with audiences that were more collaborative and that drew more from the energy in the room. So I'd ask a lot of questions of people, how they felt about things. And invariably, it was always about, in one way or another, is about the American dream and the American promise. And one night I was in the middle of a conversation in a mill town, and I talked about American dream, and we talked about how people felt, how things were compared to them. And I said out of the blue once in a way, it's like we've all become the fat Elvis. I said, like, we woke up one day, and where did all the beauty go? And where did all the dreams go? And what happened? You know, and I really felt that, and it was an epiphanous moment due to something somebody had said, and I saw the audience was affected by this idea that I touched something that was instantly understandable for people. That didn't mean it was a movie, by the way. That just meant I'd said something that resonated. Then I said it again some weeks later to another audience, and then I'd say it again, and I never say the same thing twice, to the great chagrin even to myself, because I can't remember the things I say, but it was becoming part of how I thought. And then one day I said it in front of the audience, and an older man came up to me afterward and he said, wow, that idea really hit me, that fat Elvis idea. He said, it's really amazing. He said, is that your next movie? I hadn't thought about naming the movie about that. And I said, well, maybe. And then it stayed on my mind as a framework for, you know, to a guy with a hammer, everything looks like a nail. From that moment on, everything was about Elvis. Every time I'd walk out the front door, there would be a metaphor of Elvis in America in almost everything I saw.
Well, that's